I needed to split this podcast into two parts so it didn't choke YouTube. We only have two images of women in our Art of the Indigenous Americas image set, and I'm going to leave our dismembered goddess for later. It strikes me that there are important similarities, contextual similarities, between our Yoruba senior wife and the Mayan Lady Joke. Both play a critical and essential, if still subordinate, role in the reign of their ruler husbands. The story starts here. We see Lady Joke pulling a thorned rope through her tongue in the principal form of blood sacrifice that was performed by royal women. The sacrifice mirrored the Mayan story of creation, when the gods shed their blood to create the human race. Blood is necessary for crops to grow and for babies to be born. More references to fertility. By choosing to take part in the ritual, the queen demonstrated both her moral and physical strength and her suitability to be a Mayan queen. She kneels in front of Shield Jaguar, who holds a great torch. In the next lintel, our required work, Lady Joke swoons from loss of blood while a figure emerges from the mouth of a vision serpent conjured up by her sacrifice. Note that once again we see elaborate ornamentation, a headdress, jewelry, and a beautifully rendered square-cut blouse, or huipil. In the third and final lintel, we see Lady Joke helping her husband dress for battle. She is sharing in his responsibility to protect the community and to increase its power. Note that both of the Mayan royals are depicted with large, broad noses, sloping foreheads, and prominent noses, since it's unlikely that the artists employed by the royal family were asked to depict them as ugly. This probably represents what the culture saw as beautiful, or at least as royal. And now I am going to dash through some of the other depictions of women in our required works, just to make a few key points. Like the veranda post and lintel, these works show a queen in an important but still subordinate role, though the Amarna work is uncharacteristically informal and domestic, uncharacteristic, that is, of Egyptian art. I'll talk about Hatshepsut again when we review power and authority, and for now, I'll just note that this female pharaoh felt she had to bolster her authority by portraying herself with the attributes of a male pharaoh. Greek women, unlike Greek men, kept their clothes on. The kouros, you may recall, was displayed in all his manly glory. The jewelry the woman was holding in the grave stela probably represented her dowry, which connects the woman to her husband and to her father, who would have provided the dowry. This, in turn, reinforces the male dominance of which she was a part. Symbolically, she's portrayed as a passive and secluded Athenian woman, the male ideal of a woman's social status in Athens. On the other hand, we sometimes see women performing a public role, again, with all their clothes on. Goddesses could get away with more sex appeal and with more violence. I'll close with one last observation, which I've made in earlier lectures. Although it doesn't seem to turn up much in discussions of the male gaze, I'm struck by how many works depict women as scary, and more specifically, as dangerous to men. Some of this is Freud's legacy. His focus on sex, violence, and the nexus between the two influenced many modernist works. Picasso's women are not beautiful, but they are alluring, and they are threatening. She is downright terrifying. Is the woman in this painting a lover, or a temptress, or both? Remember that Klimt lived and worked in Freud's Vienna. And remember, too, how he portrayed Judith as the dangerous, deadly seductress. So you may have been wondering why I haven't talked about the woman most often portrayed in our recorded works, the Virgin Mary. While the Virgin Mary is a very frequent subject of AP Art History exam essays, so frequent, I'm going to put her in a category by herself, and she'll get a lecture to herself. Stay tuned.